sports. It's in the game.
Thank you. everybody. I'm Larry Ridley, and this is the NFL on EA Sports. Super Bowl dreams are on the line today in the conference championship, where only one team can move on. It's the Raiders going up against the Browns. And with that, we'll send you up to First Energy Stadium in Cleveland, which is where we'll find our broadcasting team of Brandon Godden and Charles Davis. Gentlemen.
We are just a stone's throw away from the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame as we get set for football at First Energy Stadium in Cleveland, Ohio. Straight ahead, it's a clash to decide the AFC's representative in the Super Bowl. And it'll be a great one between the Oakland Raiders and the Cleveland Browns. First down to the sideline, and oh, a nice catch there. Made sure the feet were inbounds, and they were. Nothing on that one. It'll be second down. And here's a look at the starting offense. Looks like the defense in press coverage here. Carr to throw on second down. And the hit jarred it loose. It's incomplete. And now the starting defense for the Browns.
If your day involves blocking Danny Shelton, you better pack lunch and dinner. It's an all-day job.
So now an early third and 10 here on their opening drive. Throwing his car on third down. And he dropped it. Now it was tipped. Altered the ball a little bit, but he dropped it. And now fourth down.
Well, we're not playing 3 yards in a cloud of dust football anymore. I kind of get why those old school coaches sometimes didn't want to throw the football. Because if it's popped up in the air, it almost turns into slow motion, and both sides trying to get to the football, and you're holding your breath wondering whether it's going to go good or bad for your team.
It's taken to the 26. And some room to maneuver. And all the way in. Touchdown, Cleveland. A great play there. 74 yards. And the Browns have taken the early lead. They get the stop defensively, force the punt, they score without their offense even stepping on the field.
I remember playing and playing on special teams and teasing the guys on offense. Like, look, don't even worry about it. You got to just hang out over there. We'll bring this one all the way back and get the points we need. In this case, they actually got that done.
It's up and through to make it 7-0 Browns. So after the punt return touchdown, let's see what their opponents can do with this kickoff. And this will not be returnable. It's out of the back of the end zone for a touchback. The Raider offense now making their way toward the huddle. And the last drive, their first drive, 3 and out. What changes here, if anything?
I think it's making sure the guys that you trust the most with the ball, the biggest playmakers you have, that they touch it on this possession to try and get things moving.
So get it to the horses.
Without a doubt. They're the ones that typically end up in the end zone.
Going to give this time to the tailback. And brought down, but not before reaching the 45-yard line. A good pickup there of 20 yards.
Well, partner, I have to say they caught him in the right defense there. Nickel set. Fifth defensive back on the field, and they love to run against that because now you typically get a bigger blocker on a smaller defender.
Yeah, because those DBs like you, they want the interception. They're not as worried about the running play, right?
Not at all. And I still remember being in school, and one of my offensive line teammates used to say, boy, I'd love to come downfield and hit you little people.
Good run there. The offensive line and its ability to open holes in this defensive front, something they were confident they could create in this game, got the job done there, picked up the first.
and something they wanted to do. Have we ever met offensive linemen that don't want to fire out and hit people? I mean, they love the running game. Guys want to do that. And when you emphasize it, practice it, and work on it, that gives you an opportunity during the game.
9 yards is the pick up there, and they'll have a second and one.
We are watching a runner having a really nice game. Carrying it very well. Vision is excellent, but boy, look at the help he's getting. Offensive line, I think they're pretty eager to block for him.
Second down, they need less than a yard to pick up the first. They come out here in the eye. And they'll try the ground game here with the running back. And he'll go down at the 28. 3 yards there, good enough to keep the drive moving.
Second and one is often an invitation to take the big shot downfield. I bet the offensive lineman said, are you kidding? We just get on our backs and let's go get the first down. They love being physical.
On first down, Carr. And he's got his man on the out route. And inside the 20 before he's brought down. A nice pickup there of 11 yards and it'll move the sticks.
An ex-teammate used to tell me all the time, I hate experienced quarterbacks because no matter what, you really can't hide what you're doing. And I think that right there, he knew right away where the blitz was coming from, where his primary guy was going to be, and he ended up going to a secondary target for a nice game.
I was just
going to
ask you, that wasn't the primary target. He's so good at that, isn't he?
I think he knew right away that he wasn't going to get to his primary guy. I think he read that as soon as he got to the line of scrimmage, knew where the pressure was going to come from, and said, I know how to beat that, and that's what he did.
See if they stay on the ground for second down. Working from the gun, it's Carr. And he fires one that's intercepted. A great read and it's picked off. And a big turnover there as his guys will get the football back.
Brandon, this is why golfers do their best to never count a score in their head before the ball goes in the cup. This looked like a slam dunk for points on this drive, didn't it? Instead, they throw an interception and they're gonna come away empty.
And tough starting field position here. Was relatively easy to see. I noticed that from up here.
Yeah, it doesn't take a whole lot, does it? Sometimes you get multiples. What I always love on these offsides is when each side points at the other. You did it. No, you did it. They deciphered that one correctly.
Give it to him right up the gut. And he'll do a nice job here just to fight his way back to the line of scrimmage. Just a yard on the pickup there. It'll be second and four. And this O-line, it is the lifeblood of the offense.
They established the tone. Mean, nasty, physical. They can't wait to get after people. That allows the rest of the offense to feel confident.
Second down following the run.
Here we go.
He'll drop to throw. Quick hitter here, it's complete. And he'll lose yardage and be down at the 7-yard line. It's a loss of two, now third down.
They completed the screen on the perimeter, but boy, that was textbook defense. Exactly as you're taught to play against a wide receiver screen, and they snuffed it out for a loss of yardage. A dime look defensively for the Raiders on third down.
Yeah, you're right. Two extra DBs out there. They'll set up to throw. And he will find his man on the outside. It's a gain of 17, and it'll give him a first down.
I don't care how many times we see it. I still get a kick out of watching quarterbacks and receivers do the pass tree in pregame warm-up. But I always remember that when we go to practices, We see that after practices as well. They really tune it up, don't they?
They tune it up. They know why they do it for these situations. First down.
And they build that trust, and that's why they're able to find him in this type of a situation.
Now they'll run it on the toss. Fighting through. And he'll fight forward maybe to the line of scrimmage, but that's all. Credit him with a 1 yard gain there to make it 2nd and 9. And this defensive line will be looking to control the point of attack.
And that's what they've done throughout this season. This is a terrific unit. They play together very, very well, and they don't permit big plays to happen.
He's going to loft one deep left side here. And he bats it away, and it falls down incomplete.
One of the toughest things about playing defensive back is pattern reading, trying to figure out what they're doing. And on that one, they had the fly, just sending a guy downfield with the in route accompanying it, what people call a dagger route, trying to hit the guy underneath after the clear out. In this case, though, they're not able to get it done.
Yeah, they said forget the underneath route. They went for the guy on the fly, but as you said, incomplete. And it looks like we've got a dime set here defensively. Six DBs in the game. Here's a play fake as they set up to throw. He's got time in the pocket. And this is going to be caught. He won the fight for the football. 17 yards on the pickup there, and the drive will continue. He's such a good route runner. Shows it there on third down. Very proficient and a good pass.
And you know what I've observed over the years in the NFL? The better a route runner you are, the more confidence your guy's going to have in you to go to you in important times, because he can trust you being in the right spot. And they connected there and picked up a first down.
Here we go. Brad 38. Brad 38.
And he'll give it here to his running back. And taking it across midfield and inside the 45. Back with Charles Davis, I'm Brandon Gauden. The Browns with a football to begin quarter number two. And they're on the move here. They've got it 1st and 10. Now the defense definitely showing blitz here.
Let's go!
They go play action here on first down. Finding time. He rifles one that's intercepted. A great read and it's picked off. And they are going to take over right there at the 22-yard line. Now the Raiders offense, they get set to head back on the field. Looked like they had something going last drive. Then the interception happened. Will they recover?
The memory they need to keep with them is that they did have something going. They were moving the ball on offense, had a nice sequence going. Don't worry about the other part. You can't get that back. Let's go back to what you were doing well before.
I thought you were going to say they need to have no memory, but remember the good part, forget the bad.
I like that even better. We always like to talk about defense in terms of levels. First level defensive line, second level linebackers, third level defensive backs. On that run, that was what we call a first level run, and it was stopped by a second level player.
Second down, here's Carr. And he's got his man out of the backfield. That's complete. And that right there will set him back a bit on the offensive holding penalty.
And you know who you want to pressure after a penalty like that? The guy who just committed the foul. You want to see if he's going to keep his head down or if he's going to get his head right back into the game. I'd send a blitz at him right away and see if he holds up.
Now Carr throwing on second down. And incomplete there. A nice hit. Jars the ball free and brings up third down.
When it's well executed, a wide receiver screen can often be a thing of beauty. But so many things have to go right in order to complete it. Blocking out in front, timing of the quarterback with the receiver. And oftentimes, everything gets set. And guess what? They drop the football.
And he comes back with one complete. They get 7 there, but it brings up 4th.
They didn't get the first down, but I have to say, I do like the call. I like what they were trying to do. Try and hit your receiver on the run and see if he can pick it up. Keep it on his feet, get a little rack yardage.
Yeah, but a nice job defensively to get to him and keep him short of the first. But he'll get this away into the icy winter air. And now Cleveland geared up to take the field. And in enemy territory last time through the interception. We'll see what they do on this drive.
Can't wait to see how it alters what they decide to do in play calling. Do they continue to throw the ball? Do they want to lean more on the running game? It'll be an interesting sequence of plays that they've got coming up.
Does it often affect the play calling with the interception? How much does that change what you do?
I think it does, depending on why the interception was thrown. Sometimes it's just a matter of the defense made a great play, so you continue to come back. But if it's on you, if the offense just doesn't have the confidence, if they're a little bit shaky, maybe try to take the pressure off and run the ball a little bit.
And after the play on the ground, that brings up second down here.
Hey, four down.
They come out here in the eye. Now a handoff here to his running back. And they're able to get this one across the 35. A really nice pickup of 14 yards, and it moves his sticks.
And that run was what a lot of people called explosive run. Gave them good yardage, solid yardage. They feel good about the whole thing, and they did it behind a two tight end set. It's always interesting to watch what offenses want to do with the two tight ends. Sometimes they line them up together for a power set. Sometimes they put one on each side of the line of scrimmage to balance things out. No matter what, though, when you see two tight ends on the field, your first thought is to think run. In this case, the offense was able to run successfully.
So they took a shot on first down but couldn't connect.
One thing I know from experience is that when the deep ball is thrown and you're the defender, you've got to fight that little bit of panic that emerges. You've got to play the ball really well. It's a 50-50 jump ball play. And guess what? They took a shot. How are you going to win it? And in this case, they managed to get it done.
And the coach has decided to challenge this play. He has tossed down the red flag. Well, he challenged the play. It did not pay off.
And that means he lost a timeout in that challenge.
And as a coach, you hate that. Don't know if you took the advice of the player. You threw it yourself. But it didn't go your way.
At the end of the day, it all comes back to the head coach. He has the final determination on whether to actually challenge the play or not. In this case, it didn't pay off for him.
And that's got to be so heartbreaking. You throw that flag, you probably feel really confident, and then all of a sudden, boom, you lose the challenge.
Yeah, when you take a look at it, you're throwing that flag because you believe you're going to be right. And when it comes back the other way, you have to regroup.
And the Raiders call on a nickel set for third down. They'll set up a throw. Wide open receiver complete. And he's going to get this all the way down inside the 35. And that's one of his advantages of a passer, is now with his height, setting back there in the pocket, firing it over the middle, he can really see everything clearly.
It is, and I know that other quarterbacks get it done different ways, all right? You don't have to be his height to make a great play. But what he does is he takes away having to make those slide steps in the pocket to find angles to throw the ball through. He just throws right over the top of it because he can see everything. And sometimes that saves time and gets the ball to a receiver quicker. This drive is turning into an extended one, and the guy carrying the ball, he's becoming more like a body blows guy. Every carry is putting some damage on the defense. So after a while, I'm not too sure how many guys are going to want to run up and tackle him.
Into double coverage, and it's intercepted. A great read, and it's picked off. And a big turnover there as his guys will get the football back. And now Oakland ready to take the field. And last drive, three and out. Still a goose egg on the scoreboard. How do they break that goose egg?
They've got to find a way to get the ball in the hands of their playmakers, get them some space, and try and make a first down and get some momentum going. It's been a struggle for them throughout the game, and that three and out on the last possession, that told you just how stalled they are on offense.
So who will step up here? We'll see. And space opened up a bit. He's able to take this up past the 10. A nice run there, 9 yards, and it'll be second down.
And that run there does nothing but juice up the guys who are moving the football. I mean, if you're an offensive lineman, people running it, actually the guy calling plays. You're almost jumping up and down in jubilation, aren't you?
Yeah, now you've got options on second down.
And big-time options. You might want to think about play action and try and get something cheap right here over the top.
And give this time to the tailback. And they'll bring him down here up at about the 22-yard line. A nice pick up there, 10 yards, and it'll move the sticks.
He's quite an eyeful, isn't he? Big, strong, physical guy. When he came out of school and when I looked at my draft board, I went back through my notes to see how I had him rated. The number two back on my board coming out of college. Why? As I mentioned, big, strong, powerful guy, faster than you would think, and has the ability to catch the football out of the backfield, something that we didn't know he truly possessed. We saw that in the offseason workouts. Now he's putting his running ability to good use in the NFL.
It'll be a gain of four, and that'll make it a second down.
Everyone's got to be able to catch the football. Doesn't matter what position you play, but if you're on offense, be aware a ball may come your way.
Creeping up on a minute to play in this first half. Carr to throw on second down. No, he almost had it. Already with one interception, just missing his second there.
The name of the game, as always on defense, put pressure on the quarterback. And that's exactly what they've done today. It looks like they've got him a little bit rattled. That would have been the second interception in the first half. And they insert their dime package, six DBs, here on third and six.
Expecting pass all the way. Here's Carr. And he's got his man on the out route. And he's going to have the first down yardage to the 35. Now hold everything here. We're going to get a timeout by the offense. It's just their first, so they'll have two remaining here before we get to halftime. Carr now on first down. And incomplete.
Not too many things get to a quarterback of this magnitude. But I think it's safe to say that pressure can get to any quarterback.
Now, he's obviously a great franchise quarterback, but felt the pressure, threw it incomplete. Oh. 10 yards still left on second down. Again, it's Carr. Looking left side, and it's complete. And getting this just shy of midfield, they'll spot it at the 49. Now whistles come in. We're going to get a timeout here by the offense. So that means they're down to one remaining here as we head toward halftime. And here comes play number six on this drive. The defensive line disperses a little bit here, maybe expecting a pass. Now a play fake here on first down. And he fires one that's intercepted. A great read and it's picked off. And they are going to set up shop at the 40-yard line. Now it looks like we've got a Raider here slow to get up. While the trainers take a look, we'll step aside. They'll put two receivers left, two to the right. Trying to shake off the interception. He'll look to throw. On the left side, it's complete. And he's taken down, but not before he gets this into enemy territory across the 40. Looking to speed things up here, going with some tempo. They'll run it now out of the gun. And a solid run down inside the 30. Now hold everything here. We're going to get a timeout by the offense. So that means they're down to one remaining here as we head toward halftime. See if they stay on the ground for
watch
second
right,
down.
Watch right, watch right. Pick it up, guys. Pick it up.
Here we go. What? 90. What? 90. Ohio. Ohio. Tight.
Now a shotgun snap as they'll look to throw. Out to the flat. That's complete to his running back. Now whistles come in. We're going to get a timeout here by the offense. And with halftime on the horizon, they'll be out of timeouts from here forward. Third and short, they'll try and pick it up through the air. Going for it all. And he knocks the ball away, and it falls incomplete.
I like the boldness, and I like that they took a shot downfield, but it was well covered. He was able to get a hand in and knock it away.
And Santos able to put this one up and through. It's good. So we are halfway home to figuring out who will represent the AFC in the Super Bowl. As we'll send you down to Orlando, where Larry Ridley has our EA Sports Halftime Report. Larry? So both teams have their marching orders, and we'll get going again here in quarter number three. This is taken about 7 yards deep. And he'll take it back to about the 19-yard line. Here's the Browns offense now getting set to start off this third quarter. They built a good first half lead. Now they have a chance to add on to it.
And what I'm thinking is that the offensive staff spent the entire halftime just working with them on, here's what we think they're going to do to attack us in the second half. Nice first half that we've had, guys, but be prepared for some change-ups. We're going to see them when we kick it off in the second half.
See how they handle any adjustments that might be made defensively. Give them 13 on the pickup there, and it'll give the Browns a first down.
But that's the desired outcome coming out here in the second half of being able to run the football and establish a little bit of pace and maybe even a bit of dominance at the line of scrimmage, and they want that to continue. Way too early to think about this being ball control time, but the way they're running it, you got to think they may want to continue that and see if they can go ahead and grind their opponents into submission. That's another nice run, and I have to tell you, some of the coaches that I played for, their philosophies were always different when they see a guy running the ball well. Some of them wanted to immediately go to play action and throw it now because it's wide open. Well, other coaches said, you know something? Until they stop him, that big boy is going to keep getting the football, and that might be the direction that they're going to go right now.
Now they'll run it on the toss. Trying to get out wide, but he's going to be tackled right near the line of scrimmage. Just a yard on the first down carry, so it's second and nine.
Partner, we know today's NFL is really built around the guy throwing the football, but these short runs, they still pay dividends because they can take their toll on a defense, and they can add up as the game goes along. You control the clock, you control the ball.
And the Raiders have got him. Joey Bosa in there to drop him, and he continues to wreak havoc in offensive backfield. Sack number 16 on the year. Let's see, the defense might bring some added pressure as the offense is dealing with a third and long.
Don't get nervous. Come on, let's go. Flex round. Flex round.
Check 25.
Ohio.
Check
Ohio.
They'll look to throw here. He's going to wind up and air it out. And this is caught inside the five. And he'll take it into the end zone for a Browns touchdown. They're big receiver, 61 yards, and the Browns add on to their lead. And now whistles and a flag, and I think we got a jump here. Another extra point opportunity here. He's got it, and it's 17-0. Now, after the touchdown, here's Santos to kick this one away. This will be fielded at the six. And he'll take this one near the 25, call it the 26-yard line. A look at the offense now here, coming back out on the road for their first possession of the second half. They're down in this game. A chance for the offense, though, to put something on the board, get some momentum here in half two.
Try and get things kick-started for them. And you know, at the half, they discussed how they were going to get that done. This is where scripting comes into play a lot of the time.
How many plays do you script coming out of the second
half? Most of the time in the first half, you're scripting 12 to 16. I think in the second half, you're really scripting more like 8 to 10, kind of a starter or an opener, whatever terminology they use, just something to get you off to a quick start.
Second down, they'll try and run the counter. And he'll bring it up here to right at the 40-yard line. They get six on the pickup there as the drive will continue.
Well, we always talk about good down and distance allowing offenses to expand their playbook. Well, second and two, that means your playbook's wide open. You can run just about anything. But a lot of times, the play caller, he just looks down at his sheet, sees the short yardage runs, and goes to one of those.
And he'll give it here to his running back. And he's going to bowl his way forward to the 48. A good run there on first down, and it'll leave him with a second and two.
Some runs are blocked so well, you almost forget that someone has to carry the ball to gain the yardage. The leverage by the offensive line to create space up front, really well done.
Second down following the run. He'll look to throw. He's going to flip that out to the flat. It's complete. And taking it across midfield and inside the 45.
All right, I'm going to show my age here a little bit. We used to talk about running backs catching the ball as safety valves. Nowadays, they're a big part of the passing offense.
Quit acting like you're so old. You're only 65. Now back to throw. He rifles one that's intercepted. A great read, and it's picked off. And his crew will take over at their own 45-yard line. And now Cleveland geared up to take the field. And that last drive, a long drive, but not just that. They had a great air attack going. Do they stick with that?
I would think that they would, because if they were competent enough to do it on the last drive, starting backed up in their own territory, why would you change anything? They've got to be confident about what they're presenting and continue to do so.
Yeah, because the secondary, they really look clueless.
And that was amazing, because that drive went and went, no adjustments and no big plays by the defense to knock the ball away.
They'll give it to him right up the gut. And he'll be taken down at the 44-yard line. They get five out of that one, and it moves the chains.
Yeah, another good run there. He's been such a big part of their success here this afternoon. And that last carry, it puts him over 100 yards now for the day.
They go play action here on first down. He's going to look deep down the field. He couldn't quite hold it. Got hit. Ball pops out. Incomplete.
Well, they went for the big play there, but that drop could really hurt their momentum.
Let's go! 1-9!
They'll give it to him right up the gut. And able to push his way forward here for a good little gain. It'll be a pickup of five, and that leaves him with five more. Third and five now. Defense showing blitz. To throw. And oh, he took that in one-handed. What a grab. They pick up 12 on the play there, and they move the chains.
That was a terrific catch. I mean, to go up there and get it one-handed like that, but I almost want to go into that riff about back in my day, the gloves weren't quite like this.
When did gloves really become prevalent, just in general?
I think in the 80s. I think as we started to move through the 80s, especially as we got towards the latter part of that. But a lot of those were really like baseball batting gloves to begin with not much of a tacky area on the glove. In fact, there was none. I actually remember in cold weather games wearing the old scuba gloves, which you'd wear in diving, but they would split too easily in the course of the game. Then the glove manufacturers got smart and started adding to it. And here we are today.
And inside the 20 before he's brought down.
When a coaching staff sees their team run the ball this successfully in the fourth quarter, they're really excited, because you can plan for a running game all you want and want to press that advantage when you get it. But for the most part, it's a little bit of a surprise. And right now, they've got to keep that going, want to continue to grind out the clock, because it's definitely in their favor at this stage of the game. Can they close the game out and continue to do exactly what we just saw there, and that's run the football? So much of this game is about leverage. We always talk about low man wins in the trenches. Well, it's like that at just about every position. And sometimes, if you lose that leverage and you're losing the battle, just jump up at the line of scrimmage and try and bat the ball away. And that's exactly what happened there.
Here we go. Red 38.
He'll try again with the arm here on second down. And that's going to be caught for a Browns touchdown. Their big tight end. 16-yard touchdown, and the Browns add 6 to their lead. They had the lead in the fourth, but still passing, finding the big target for the touchdown. Now that lead grows even more.
Everybody gets to join in the fun. You know, it doesn't have to just be the wide receivers catching touchdown passes. The tight end doesn't just have to do just the dirty work inside. He gets a chance to get into the end zone as well.
After the touchdown here, Santos to kick this one away. And that'll carry over the back line of the end zone for a touchback. And now Oakland ready to take the field. And the interception last time on the opponent's side of the field, certainly not what they wanted.
Put it mildly, that is so frustrating, because that signifies there's a drive going on. You're in a good spot. Great place to run some of your best offense. Instead, they turn the ball over.
Yeah, turn the ball over last time. See if they can avoid doing it here.
Here we go.
Trying to shake off the interception from the last drive. He'll look to throw. And it pops free. The collision there jarred the ball loose and brings up second down.
And he still doesn't have a catch. We're into the second half. I think it's a little bit of a surprise to me, but that was one he should have caught.
Absolutely. That was his best opportunity right there. He dropped it.
Here we go now. Blue lining.
They'll run it now out of the gun. And he is met at the line of scrimmage, and he goes down right there. Calling no gain on the run there, and now they'll be looking at a third down.
No gain on that run, and while this team is down, they're not out of it by any stretch of the imagination. Maybe you just have to think about different style of running in order to get this guy going.
Offense trying to avoid stalling out, facing a third and 10.
Hurry up, here we go. B-19.
They'll send a receiver in motion left.
Lucky 56.
On third down, he'll drop to throw. And that is incomplete. And the coach has decided to throw the red flag. He will challenge this play. Well, he challenged the play. It did not pay off.
And that means he lost a timeout in that challenge.
And as a coach, you hate that. Don't know if you took the advice of the player. You threw it yourself, but it didn't go your way.
At the end of the day, it all comes back to the head coach. He has the final determination on whether to actually challenge the play or not. In this case, it didn't pay off for him.
And that's got to be so heartbreaking. You throw that flag, you probably feel really confident, and then all of a sudden, boom, you lose the challenge.
Yeah, when you take a look at it, you're throwing that flag because you believe you're going to be right. And when it comes back the other way, you have to regroup.
Here we go.
Now a handoff here to his running back. And for one of the few times here today, this run's not going to go anywhere. That's going to go as a loss of a yard, and it'll be second down. Throw firing quickly here, and that's complete. Only 3 yards on the catch, It's third down.
The goal of a wide receiver screen is get enough blockers in front to create a wall and let him pick his spot to run the football. How about the defense there swarming to it and not allowing that to happen? Did not let him get downfield.
So a third and eight. Looking to throw. Man over the middle, and it's complete. 17 yards on the pickup there, and also a first down.
And fits the exact right word. Over the middle, there's almost always traffic, so anytime you're a receiver in that area, you're not just focused on catching the football. You're wondering where the collision's going to come from, right? Because there's almost always someone there able to concentrate, catch it, and even added a little extra at the end with a short run.
And he might have got this across midfield, not by much. They'll mark it down at the 49. A gain of three, second down.
Well, so many times we look at a short run and we praise the offense for trying to set the tempo and establish things, but the defensive guys, hey, they just won the battle there. It wasn't a big run given up. They don't always have to absorb the body blow. Sometimes they dish them out themselves.
And after the play on the ground, that brings up second down here. They'll need to get the play off quickly. They'll look to throw. He's going to rifle one deep left side. And he can't hang on. That's definitely going to be one he wishes he had back. Incomplete in the end zone.
And when all else fails as a defender, when you're not there in the coverage, your best friend is exactly what we saw there. A big play shot taken by the offense. Unfortunately, it ended in a big drop.
Here we go. Ohio.
Out of the gun now on third down. Surveying the field. And this time he's got the hookup. It's complete. A good gain of 14 there, and it moves the chains. And defensively, they just don't seem to have much of an answer for this passing game.
Not at all. Look at the confidence that's exhibited here. With that type of a lead, clock on their side, instead of running it, they're still throwing it, trying to pick up first downs and keeping the football.
So here we go, first and 10 now. Time running out here on the play clock. They'll run it now out of the gun. And he's going to fight his way forward here for a modest gain. He'll get a nice chunk there on the first down run, and it's second and four. Time for a break. Back to wrap up the AFC Championship game after this. Second down and four. And the D-line pinching together must be expecting the run. Back to throw here. And the hit jarred loose. It's incomplete.
Timing's crucial in any route thrown, but when you throw an out, so many things are going through the mind of the receiver. Catching the ball, timing it up with the quarterback. Are my feet going to get down inbounds? On that play, all those things going through his head might have caused him to drop it.
This will be the eighth play of the drive here. Third and four. Now they'll throw here, out of the gun. Under pressure, and he will go down. Sacked back at the 38. Man, he got in there so quickly, Charles. What could the offense have done to adjust and account for that?
But what you're hoping is that you figure out and you see and get a clue that maybe there's going to be some pressure coming at you, and you change the blocking schemes. Maybe you go to max protection. The biggest ones, maybe you bring your running back in to try and keep you clean. But in that case, that didn't happen. Zero accountability, and a sack resulted.
So an empty possession there. What do you think went wrong, Charles?
Well, it looked like maybe the plant leg might have given way just a little. And when that happens, guys have a tendency to pull through the ball to compensate. And in doing so, sent this one off target.
They'll come out throwing here on first down. Throwing left side here, and it's complete. 12 yards that time for number 12 as they move the chains.
That was a nicely run slant route. And what the receiver's trying to do is make the defender think he's going upfield for a deeper route. And then breaks it off, usually after about 3 to 4 steps, and cuts towards the middle of the field. And now what he's trying to do is use his body to keep the defender away from the football and get the quarterback a really nice target. On every offensive coordinator, every play caller sheet, they have about five or six plays per game that they call shot plays or big plays, and you don't get many opportunities to dial them up, and they just did, and they drop it with a great chance to make a big play. That's going
to
hurt.
And to give this time to the tailback. Pretty good running there, 9 yards. Sets up a third and one. And that looked like some pretty easy yardage there right up the gut.
And he's a guy that has some height to him. So when you don't have to drop a shoulder or create or get through contact or trash, makes it a lot easier to stay upright, see the field, and make a run as we just saw there.
It's a pickup of 6 and good enough to move the chains.
Third and one, partner. No need to be fancy there. Just use some force and move forward and pick up the first down.
They go play action here on first down. Ball hit as he throws there, incomplete.
Really nice play by the guys on the defensive side of the ball, but for the guys on the offensive line, they're doing a nice job of trying to protect their passer. But when a guy hops in the air and goes airborne to try and knock one away, it's difficult because you can't reach out and grab him. That'll be a holding penalty. So all you're trying to do is make some type of a play on him, make some type of contact to try and get his arms out of the sky.
Oh, the ball comes out on the hit, but they'll say it's incomplete.
Gotta give some credit. They're able to hop up in the air and bat that one away. And that's frustrating for an offensive lineman because the only recourse is when he goes in the air to try and get some type of a pop or a shove, hoping to bring his arms down.
They'll look to throw here. And he comes back with one complete. And they do stop him, but he takes it all the way to the 2.
Of course, the catch was nice, but how about what happened after? Able to stay on his feet and gain all that additional yard.
Now hold everything here. We're going to get a timeout by the offense. That'll leave him with just one remaining in this fourth quarter of play.
What a game this defense has played. They're pitching a shutout, so it'd be fun to watch down the stretch to see if their defensive coordinator continues to be as aggressive as he's been all game long.
They come out here in the eye. He'll drop to throw. Now bottled up. Fumble. It's out. The big fella. He finds some open field here. He's at the 50. And a big return will get him all the way down to the 35. And now Cleveland geared up to take the field. They have the dream scenario you hope for coming into the game. Just one kneel here, and this game should be over.
That's always the final play of preparation each week. The practicing of the kneel-down formation, the victory formation. We've got a game in hand, and that's all they're going to want to do now. They'll put someone back deep just in case something goes haywire. But all in all, take the snap, kneel down, and shake hands. Yes, get out of there.
That one looks like he'll throw here. And it's incomplete. They're still throwing to the very end. But now this game is over. This was the goal before they started the season, to play in a Super Bowl, and that's exactly what they're going to do.
And this is why songs are written about teams. Okay, you go back, some teams wrote up earlier in the season about their goal of getting to the Super Bowl. This one, they're going to be able to break it out now because their goal was to get there, and they achieved it. How about that? That's pretty fantastic.
And that'll close the books on the conference championship. For Charles Davis, myself, Brandon Gordon, and our entire crew, we'll talk to you in 2 weeks from the Super Bowl.